Greetings. Welcome to the Sanders Report. My friends, I have a show for you today. We are sitting in the shadow of one of the greatest periods in American history. The first black president of the U.S. has done his 8 years, and he has made his way, and may he go with God and may his next career and his wife and his family be blessed. However, now it's time to sum it up, my friends. Now it is time to look to see, was the Obama administration fruitful or fruitless? Every great person has both that they have to look at. And my friends, let me say from the beginning, there's no one right answer, but if you look at the whole, and that's what I ask you to do. So helping me do this, I have brought together two of the finest minds that the East Coast has. I have Dr. Bruce Miroff, and I'm going to read part of his extensive bio. He is, of course, a professor of political science, and he is a Collins Fellow who is an expert on the American presidency. Thank you for being here. I appreciate that. And, of course, Dr. Leslie Branch, who is going to take the fruitless position. Of course, Dr. Miroff is going to take the fruitful position. Now, Professor Branch is the racial policy scholar and a Fulbright specialist in race, ethnicity, and religion in American politics. And I thank you for being here also.
Thank you.
My friends, the rules are no hitting below the belt, no gouging of the eyes, unless I turn my back for more than 2 seconds. Having said that, and of course to the audience, I'm joking. But having said that, Dr. Miroff, you believe it, the Obama administration and the legacy that he leaves has been fruitful. Why is that?
So much to say. Just to start off with a few things. He broke the mold on who could be president of the United States, hopefully forever. He, if slowly and painstakingly, brought us out of one of the worst economic conditions that the United States has ever faced. He broke important new ground in developing an active national government that can meet the fundamental needs of its citizens, particularly in the area of health care. There were considerable advances in diversity. For example, no president has made so many appointments to the judiciary of women and people of color. And he made bold moves in international relations, such as the opening to Cuba, or the advance in struggling against the enormous danger of climate change.
Well, that's quite a list. Dr. Branch, I believe that you have a list, too, on why he was fruitless.
Well, indeed I do, Senator Sanders. And my list is framed based on race and rhetoric. And although President Obama indeed did all of the things that my esteemed colleague said, what I would suggest is that when it comes to people of color, particularly black folks, they did not do as well under President Obama. And the rhetoric that he used when speaking to black people of color really chastised them and blamed them, in effect, for why they are where they are. And I would suggest that if we look at a lot of the empirical literature, black people are getting college degrees in record numbers. Black people are frugal. They are more frugal than white folks. Black folks are doing the things that the narrative says that we should do, yet we have a 2-for-1 racial unemployment gap, which has existed since the Great Depression or even before then. And I would suggest that there is a perpetual crisis of unemployment in the black community. I would also suggest that the wealth gap widened under President Obama. And as my colleague said, in terms of boldness, yes, there were some bold things that he in fact did do. But in terms of some of his socioeconomic policies, I think he could have gone more bold. Some colleagues and my own mentors have come out with things such as baby bonds, which is a bond for every child that is born, but it is meted out based on the wealth of family. And as the child grows, and once they become 18, that bond could be used for something that would help them to make socioeconomic gains, like maybe start a business, pay for education, home down payment for homes. And there are some other things that he could have done in terms of being more bold in terms of socioeconomic policy. So while I do agree that there are some things that were positive, when we look at black folks, they did not do well under this president.
Professor Miroff, Obama fails black people? What does this mean?
Let me first talk about those things that presidents can control and those things that presidents can't control. We have to start with the fact that Obama inherited one of the worst economies, that much of the decline in black wealth, to my knowledge, was in the collapse of housing values and in the rate of foreclosures. And those really were underway when he walked in the door of the White House. The housing market collapsed the year before he became president. In addition, we have to remember that President Obama faced an opposition Congress, or at least one House of Congress, for 6 of his 8 years. And so that many of the things he might have liked to do, or that seem like bold, good ideas, and the idea you mentioned I think is a great idea, but the question is whether those things ever had any chance in the world of being adopted. The final thing is that how we measure the impact on any particular group, in this case African Americans, needs to include not just things that directly benefit a group, but that indirectly benefit a group. For example, by expanding health care to 20 million more people. That was a policy that improved health insurance for all groups, including many African Americans, both the creation of the subsidies and the expansion of Medicaid. So that if we look at the classic idea that politics is based on the limits of the possible, that Obama didn't do everything that he might have done, but that many of the things that he is charged with not doing were probably not something that any president could have done, given the context, given the circumstances, given the opposition he faced.
Let me depress you, Professor. Elizabeth Warren, now Senator Warren, right, and others spoke of other ways that he could have addressed the housing crisis, right, which took away more than 40% of total black wealth since, right, slavery. They gave other ways that he could have addressed. He chose not to do that. Why was that?
Well, I can't, I'm not privy to the inner reasons why, and certainly if there's one area where he might be faulted of not doing enough, that's probably it, of not doing more to put pressure on the banks in terms of foreclosures, which was a key contributor to that. He was preoccupied with bringing the economy out of great crisis. The problem was he faced a shaky financial system, and perhaps he was a little bit too susceptible to the influence of Wall Street and the financial market. But again, there's only so much he could have done. Many people were being foreclosed on. The scale was massive, again, people of all races. And certainly he might have alleviated that by being stronger on foreclosure and being tougher on the banks. But again, the idea that he could have reversed collapse of the housing market and the explosion of foreclosures overstates the power of the presidency. People often assume that what happens under a president, economically speaking, whether it's good times or whether it's bad times, is really in the control of the presidency. So that Bill Clinton presided over very good times. Barack Obama came in under bad times, which had been improving by the time he left the presidency. But Bill Clinton benefited from many positive developments, like the computer revolution at the time, just as Barack Obama was dealt a very bad hand on the economy, coming in right as the economy in general, because the housing collapse and the collapse of major financial institutions brought the rest of the economy down in 2008, 2009. So that the suffering, which was in many groups, but African Americans disproportionately suffered. Some of that was, he could have done more, but a lot of it we tend to blame or credit, like in Bill Clinton's case, more than is realistic about what power or lack of power presidents actually have when it comes to the economy.
Well, Professor Branch, we've heard a very bold way of looking at it, but you differ. I want to hear exactly what you believe that he could have done and under what conditions.
Well, again, going back to some of the policies that I mentioned, baby bonds, wealth creation policies, I really think that even with a Congress that wasn't willing to work with him, he could have very well used some of his power of the pen, so to speak, in terms of executive actions. I really think also the way he framed a lot of the discussion, particularly with regard to black people, was one that undercut their collective action to lobby for policies that would have socioeconomic benefits for them. Under the Reagan administration, i.e. the Reagan Revolution, we saw the rolling back of a lot of affirmative action policies through the placement of federal judges and things like that. So I really think that under Obama, when he came in, the rhetoric that he used to talk to black people really undercut, again, as I said, their ability to pay attention to what was happening to them financially, socioeconomically.
Why don't you give us some examples of this rhetoric that you speak of?
So, for example, in my dissertation and in a book that I will be having published shortly, my dissertation looked at narratives of civil rights leaders and narratives of people in the post-racial era. And these narratives were of black leaders. And I did a comparative analysis between how leaders of the civil rights era shaped the narratives to get people to focus on what they should be pressing government to do. So in Martin Luther King's time, in Malcolm X's time, in Stokely Carmichael's time, they motivated folks of color to see that there was a socioeconomic gap and that they, although there were some gains that had been made, that they shouldn't be overly optimistic. I've termed this phrase called paradoxical ebullience. And Martin Luther King, in one of his speeches on the realistic look at racial progress, he told folks to be realistic. So yes, we have made some gains, but let's not get complacent to the point that we stop lobbying. And what we see when we are looking at post-racial narratives by leaders, excuse me, black leaders, particularly Barack Obama, he's telling people to stop complaining. Nobody cares about what you've gone through, which is what he told the Morehouse men at their commencement address. What you went through or what you have gone through pales in comparison to what people like Martin Luther King and Ralph Abernathy have gone through, and they didn't complain. But the fact of the matter is they did. They were, you know, protesters. And so his consistent call for blacks to stop making particularistic claims and to bind their grievances to the grievances of greater America, I think is erroneous, because the grievances that black folks experienced back then and which still are impacting them today were particularistic, based on policies that were created based on race and aimed right at black folks.
So Dr. Miroff, Obama beat up on black folk?
Well, I would say it was two-sided. Some of the time, Obama had a kind of pull up by your bootstraps message, although that's hardly new, and Martin Luther King often gave sermons to that effect. But the other thing is, it's a little awkward to compare President Obama to civil rights leaders of the past, because they were black movement leaders outside of government. And he was president of the United States and not simply a black president for the black community. And he had to walk a line. I think above and beyond the kind of messages which Professor Branch has suggested are a flaw of Obama's, and I don't completely disagree, we have to realize that he also developed an enormous bond with and an encouragement of the black community. And in both of his elections, 2012 as well as 2008, he received over 90% of the black vote. If we look to those moments, whether his speech at Selma on the 50th anniversary or his speech in the Charleston church after the slaughter of congregants, we see that he developed an enormous kind of emotional resonance with that community. It was striking to me that one of his most powerful critics among black intellectuals, Ta-Nehisi Coates, wrote basically a valedictory to Obama in the Atlantic magazine about 2 months ago, and talked about how, although he had been very critical of Obama, that as he viewed him from a longer perspective and got to know him through a series of interviews with him, he came to have a very different view of Obama, not uncritical in the ways he'd been, but understanding the kinds of cross pressures Obama faced. And in that sense, that Obama always was bound to have as the first black president, a complicated relationship, because no president can be a president primarily identified with one particular group. Presidents are supposed to be representatives of the whole people.
But wouldn't you say that if a group gave 90% of a vote, then they would have some special calling, something you'd have to do especially? Now, I'm a politician, unabashedly so, and I understand that you want to feed your base.
Right.
You want to continue and grow a base. Now, I understand that a base should forever grow. It should expand. It should not be narrow. My base is not simply one group or one type of people. There's a bunch of people who make up my base. However, Ulysses Grant gave us his favorite, his famous dictum. What was that again? The spoils go to the victor. Was there any attempt by President Obama to spoil his base?
Well, again, distinguish between both the gestures and also the appointments. For example, President Obama had two attorney generals, the most important person in terms of justice. They were both African American in his 8 years. And Eric Holder, in particular, because he wasn't president of the United States, felt freer to speak about questions of race and justice in ways that no previous attorney general of the United States had ever spoken. So in terms of Obama's the first president to actually visit a federal prison, he wound up his administration with record numbers of commutations of sentences, particularly on drug offenses, which were disproportionately people of color, black and Latino. So in areas where he could act through appointments, as I said, in the federal judiciary, all those are very important for the lives of people of color. Who's on the bench? What kind of policy is there for the criminal justice system? Dealing with mass incarceration. He's raised those kind of issues, but he's also, of course, had to deal with issues that touch everybody. Take climate change, right? Climate change is something that threatens every human being on the planet. And that is not a racially particularistic thing, but it is one crucial for people's future, their children's, their grandchildren's future.
Now, Professor Branch, you've heard that too. That he never signed up to be the black president, that he signed up to be the American president, and as such, he dealt with American issues. Mm-hmm. And there may have been some benefit to black people, but he never signed up to be the black president.
Yes, and that is true. That notwithstanding, in his farewell address, he said part of the reason, you become president, or maybe go into politics, is to improve the lives of people. And when we look at the statistics on socioeconomic well-being, over the 8 years of his presidency, I don't think that people that look like me did better under him.
Now, in a moment, I'm going to ask you for some of those statistics that you're speaking of. I will switch back to my colleague for a second and let you muster your ammunition. Now, Professor Miroff, how did you feel when you saw Obama the first time? You were a civil rights worker in South Carolina. Right. How did you feel when you saw this bold figure stride across the screen?
I was thrilled. I actually saw Obama speak at a conference in Washington, D.C. in 2007, and six of the eight contenders for the Democratic presidential nomination were speaking at this event, and their campaign workers were handing out, posters and yard signs and such, and I went home with an Obama sign and had an Obama sign on my lawn in the summer of 2007. So to me, having been involved in the civil rights movement back in the 1960s, this was the fulfillment of a dream. This was the sense that I teach the presidency, and not only has every president been white, but almost all of them have had Anglo-Saxon names. There's been so little diversity, even compared to Congress or the Supreme Court. Now, this was a white Anglo-Saxon institution. even if we go to the Clintons and the Bushes and, till Obama. And to have not only a black president, but with someone whose name, if you look at the list, the little children memorize. My daughter did, like many kids, when they're four or five, they memorize presidents from Washington to the current president. Hmm. And when you get to the name Obama, it is such a kind of rupture in American history, a wonderful rupture. The first time that the country kind of breaks from this, this tradition that has long been one of the underside of traditions, white supremacy, is an American tradition. And this was the biggest rupture in that tradition. And I think that was an enormous transformation. I've been, like many people, mesmerized by that picture of the little African-American boy touching his hair. That picture is, in a sense, is one of Barack Obama's legacies. Mm.
Well put. Now, Professor Branch, you have some statistics to show that black folk have not done well under President Obama?
So I do. And the areas that I focus on in my research are wealth. And wealth is extremely important because with wealth, if you have wealth, you can overcome pretty much any of the other socioeconomic disparities. Wealth allows you to move to a better neighborhood. Wealth allows you to send your children to better schools. Wealth allows you to hire better legal representation if your child or you get in trouble. Wealth allows you to weather unemployment. And so the wealth gap under Obama exploded from, I want to say, between 10 to 12 to 1 to, I believe, 19 or 20 to 1. And yes, while that may have had something to do with...
I'm sorry, you're going to have to explain what does that mean. Who are we comparing it to?
So in terms of wealth, we are looking at wealth between blacks and whites.
Okay.
And so for every dollar of wealth a white person has, black people have 6 cents. And so again, with the widening of the wealth gap, blacks have just become so much socioeconomic disparate that in order for them to catch up, studies done by Derek Hamilton, Sandy Darity, and others say that black people would have to work and save their income for 3 years to close that gap. And of course, that's not possible. And so, like Professor Miroff, yesterday when I was walking home, it did my heart so wonderful to see little black girls and boys talking about, oh, I wish Obama, you know, were still in. And then one was like, well, you know, he can't do that anymore. He's, you know, done his time. And these were little folks, right? And so I do like that he has incited an interest in politics, whereas, you know, the claim was made that black people were apathetic, and I don't necessarily buy that, but it was very heartening to see people, young people, little folks, children, who were engaging in a political discussion. When I was seven, I was not interested in politics. And so in that way, it's very important because the impact that Obama has even on the lives of young people and his rhetoric is very important, right? So yes, the bootstrap rhetoric is very important, but I just think that because he spoke to them in such a way and told them to not complain and they cannot hold the system accountable, even if racism and discrimination are still happening, in some ways it undercut protest politics in black people. And you never heard really, except a few dissenting academics, I guess among which I'm included, complaining about what's going on. In the Atlantic and the Brookings Institute, they put out a piece in September of last year that even among the poorest blacks, they were still the most optimistic, and they thought that it was surprising. In a TED talk that I did, I said it was more than surprising, it's detrimental, because... Yeah.
Now, only because time is not our friend, I'm going to ask that you make your last 1 minute in summation. You've got, I'll talk for 30 seconds so that you can get your 1 minute summation together. I want to thank both of you for coming in here. You're from New York City, and you were, what town was that again, sir?
Del Mar,
okay. We will be speaking in the future as we do this again. Now, without further ado, it was fruitful. Why?
Well, Barack Obama attempted to do many things that had long been undone for all kinds of people, including African Americans. He didn't achieve many things he hoped to achieve. He faced a very difficult context. I would add that for all groups, economic inequality increased under Obama, as it had done under all the presidents before him, because of deep structural changes in the economy, even more than public policies. But nonetheless, in terms of achieving what a president on the side of liberal policy and liberal values, that he is probably the most important and maybe the most fruitful president since Franklin Roosevelt.
Okay, but this was fruitless. Why?
Well, because as it is important to any disparate group or any group, period, nobody gets anywhere on their own. I think his rhetoric undercut collective action in individuals to lobby for what is best for them. I think that he could have been more progressive and bold in the policies that he rolled out, not just that benefit blacks, but that benefit people who are disparate in general. And had he done that, I think on some levels we may not be facing some of the things that we're facing today, because there's just been this backlash, I would suggest, and people really understand that they're not better off, and they, in fact, are worse off in some instances.
Well, there you have it, my friends. Now it's your turn. My telephone number is 718-523-3069. I want you to pick up the phone and call me with your position. You can leave a message for me, and I want you to tell me, was it fruitful or was it fruitless? You've heard the experts, and now it's your time. Again, my name is State Senator James Sanders, Jr., and I'm very proud to be here, and I represent the 10th Senatorial District in New York City, and this has been the Sanders Report.